O God, you have taught us to keep all your commandments by loving you and our neighbor. Grant us the grace of your Holy Spirit, that we may be devoted to you with our whole heart and united to one another with pure affection through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Reading from the book of Genesis. The man said to Rebekah and her household, I am Abraham's servant. The Lord has greatly blessed my master, and he has become wealthy. He has given him flocks and herds, silver, gold, male and female slaves, camels and donkeys. And Sarah, my master's wife, bore a son to my master when she was old, and he has given him all that he has. My master made me swear, saying, you shall not take a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanites, in whose land I live. But you shall go to my father's house, to my kindred, and get a wife for my son. I came today to the spring and said, O Lord, the God of my master Abraham, if now you will only make successful the way I am going. I am standing here by the spring of water. Let the young woman who comes out to draw, to whom I shall say, please give me a little water from your jar to drink. And who will say to me, drink, and I will draw from my camels also. Let her be the woman by whom the Lord has appointed for my master's son. Before I had finished speaking in my heart, there was Rebekah coming out with her water jar on her shoulder. And she went down to the spring and drew. And I said to her, please let me drink. She quickly let down her jar from her shoulder and said, drink, and I will also water your camels. So I drank, and she also watered the camels. Then I asked her, whose daughter are you? She said, the daughter of Bethuel, Nahor's son, and whom Malachi bore to him. So I put the ring on her nose and the bracelets on her arm. Then I bowed my head and worshiped the Lord and blessed the Lord, the God of my master Abraham, who had led me right away to obtain the daughter of my master's kinsman for his son. Now then, if you will deal loyally and truly with my master, tell me, and if not, tell me, so that I may turn either right hand to the left. And they called Rebekah, and she said, will you go with this man? She said, I will. So they went away to her sister's Rebekah and her nurse, along with Abraham's servant and his men. And they blessed Rebekah and said to her, may you, our sister, become thousands of barons. May your offspring gain possession of the gates to their force. Then Rebekah and her maids rose up, mounted the camels, and followed the man. Thus the servant took Rebecca and went his way. Now Isaac had come from the Beerus Russia and was settled in Nigra. Isaiah went out in the evening to walk in the field, and looking up, he saw camels coming. And Rebecca looked up, and when she saw Isaac, she slipped quickly from the camel and said to the servant, "Who is the man over there walking in the field to meet us?" The servant said, "It is my master." So she took the veil down, had done. Then Isaac brought her into his mother Sarah's tent. He took Rebecca and said, "Become his wife," and he loved her. So Isaac was comforted after his mother's death. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree that the law is good. But in fact, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells within me, that is, in my flesh. I can will what is right, but I cannot do it. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I do. Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self, but I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
We played the flute for you, and you did not dance the well, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by the deeds. At that time, Jesus said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent, and have revealed them to the ancients. Yes, Father, for such was your wisdom revealed. All things have been handed over to me by my Father. And no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son. And anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him, come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble of heart. You will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. The Gospel of the Lord. To make the team work easier and more efficient. So if Jesus is telling you here that his yoke is easy, if you envision that as you're carrying the burdens to the Lord, and yet he's saying his yoke is easy and the burden is light, and I just said it's not meant that you dump everything on Jesus and go your merry way. You're supposed to do it as a team. So if Jesus has a light yoke, which in the Greek transfers to mean a kind yoke, that yoke is going to be much easier to bear if you share it with Jesus as opposed to trying to carry it all by yourself. For those of you that were here on Good Friday, I thought I was Superman and tried to carry that big wooden cross by myself. My back paid the price for the next couple of days. I had someone that wanted to help me, but I'm like, I got this. But next year I know better. I need to take that help that's offered. So I had to go back and sort of undo some thinking that I had been, I say taught or had just sort of learned over the years. Take your burden to the Lord, take it to the cross, leave it there, go on about your merry way. But as we know in life, nothing really works that way. You still have to do your part. If you are saying, I need help with something, well, you can go to a person and say, this is what I need, but you're still expected to contribute something in order for that to not all be placed on one person's feet so that things can go smoother and oftentimes faster. And if you think about it, think back on a moment or a time when you had an issue or a problem and you said that you prayed to the Lord, but yet you didn't really give the Lord time to work. You went ahead and tried to fix it yourself, or you went ahead and tried to find someone else or try to find an easy way or a shortcut around something. And I think you probably found that it probably took longer, or you probably got a result that you didn't get to expect. Oftentimes, if you take it to the Lord, leave it there, and yet remember you still have a part to do, then things might happen and come out a lot better. And all of that ties back into faith, which I talk about all the time. You say, I pray, and I pray, and I pray, but yet we still try to find ways to speed God up. And as I've learned, as most of you have probably learned, God works in God's own time. And oftentimes we pray for things and we think we know how it's going to work out, but God might have a different way of getting to the same result. And sometimes you might have to be made to work or to endure something in order for that prayer that you pray for to be answered. And then you step back and you think about it, you say, God answered my prayer, but it wasn't how I thought it was going to be answered. I thought I would just pray and boom, it would be fixed. But you had to go through something, or had to do some work as well in order for that prayer answered. And I've had two revelations lately. I'm like, God answered my prayer. I didn't realize it had been answered until I stepped back one day and said, well, I did ask for this, but I didn't know if he meant for me to have to do A, B, or C. Now, these yokes that I talk about, I've never seen one, I think, except for in the movies or on the Westerns or whatever. But those of you that know about yokes, do they really work or do they break sometimes or what happened? Jordan's just saying yes, they did break or they work.
They do break.
Okay. So, as I just mentioned, with a yoke, Jesus is teaching us to be a team. That you can't be a team with one person that's going over here doing this, or one over here doing this. What if one oxen decided, I'm not moving today, and one oxen said, I'm ready to go over here, your yoke would probably break or something catastrophic would happen. I saw a movie recently where they were trying to get this donkey to move, and the donkey was like, I'm not moving this here. It's pushing, pushing, pushing. And the donkey was like, you can push all you want, I'm not playing it, not today. And so what Jesus is saying here is, we have got to learn how to be a team. He's saying, learn from me by working beside me and watch how I do it. And he gives us many examples throughout scripture as how he does things. If you think back on it, Jesus is never really doing anything by himself until the last minute, when usually a disciple or a group of people have decided to do something different, or they've gotten scared and they have to come to the rescue. You think about the disciples being in the boat on the sea. He was trying to rest, and also he probably hears there might be a wailing or something, and he has to go walk on the water and go say, peace be still. Or God, when he promised the wandering Israelites for a promised land, though they got discouraged and wandering around for 40 years, and finally after 40 years, as God said, you know what, they've learned enough, let me get them to the promised land. But they had to go through all those trials in order to get there. And we can learn a lot from Jesus as to how to handle difficult times, just by watching how he dealt with people and situations in his time when they did not want to be part of his team. In the end, they ended up having to be, because if not, things were not going to work out the way that they had intended. Notice I said they had intended, not Jesus had intended. So why do sometimes when we get this invitation, this wonderful invitation from Jesus, we still turn our backs on it? Or we send back an RSVP that says, not interested or not attending. Because we think we can do it ourselves. We think we know better than God. I don't know how to solve this problem. But if you do, why bother? Jesus was asking or praying about it. I want this resolved right now. Not 2 months from now, not 6 months from now, but right now. And we all know that rarely happens. Walking with Jesus requires going through the fire with him. You just can't dump your burdens on Jesus and just walk away and say, let me know it's done. We all have a role to play, and a team is made up of many people, not just one person. It's called a solo. But Jesus, I've done everything I'm supposed to do. Why is my prayer being answered? Have you really done all that you can do or are supposed to do? Or did you just find a simpler way and figure that Jesus has it now? I have nothing else I need to do. I can go on about my merry way and it all can work out. We often have heard people who say, I want a better job, but yet have done nothing to facilitate getting that better job other than taking Jesus. You still have to update your resume, your vita, all those things that you have to do. You still have to do your part in order so that you all have team well. God takes care of the spiritual, you take care of the physical, you all work together. Jesus in his ministry is always teaching us and encouraging us, and throughout throughout the Gospels and even beyond the Gospels, if you read the entire New Testament, you're going to see time and time again where Jesus is always showing and modeling for us that we should behave and live and also work as a team. And if you have time this week, just choose one of the Gospels and just read it. And you'll see many examples of how, even though he sends out his disciples and even though he commissions 70 plus people, he still has to be there for them. He doesn't expect them to know it all perfectly or to know how to get it done right away. He's still there to be their support system. He didn't always tell them that, but they know in the end that Jesus will come through because they have seen him perform miracles before. Now, sometimes we have self-imposed burdens, and what are those? Or what are some examples of self-imposed burdens? And there's no right or wrong answer here.
Dieting.
Very good. We talked about yesterday during Ash Wednesday where I boldly brought my Coke and honey bun and gave it to Chorus. I was going to conquer this. That was a self-imposed burden because by the end of the week I was off the wagon. I didn't tell y'all that. And after Easter, when she did what I asked her to do, she brought me back the Coke and the honey bun in the bag. I went in my office and closed the door. The honey bun was still fresh. Okay. Self-imposed burdens, things that are unrealistic, things that you have good intentions for. And I will admit, I didn't ask God to help me with that decision I made, that burden I put on myself. Sometimes we put on the burdens of perfection, or put on the burden I want to do everything right in a perfect way. Those are self-imposed burdens because there's no such thing as perfection. And again, we always need somebody to sort of walk with us. Spiritually, of course, Jesus, but physically, you still need someone to help you. And had I asked someone to help me to hold me accountable, that may have worked. But some people felt sorry for me and they still slipped me coats in the refrigerator and perished. I was doing it from the beginning. In our meeting yesterday, we had a strategic planning meeting, and we were trying to figure out why, you know, churches were declining in attendance, this, that, and the other. And I made a statement, we often forget that we're living in a secular world. And although we're in the church, and we see other people in church, we forget the larger world has turned secular. So again, you're trying to accomplish something which can oftentimes seem like a burden, and you're fighting against someone, a world that is not in walk with the Lord. So it's easy to become discouraged, but you have to stay encouraged and stay in prayer because, as I was saying to a friend of mine, the church is not dying, the people are dying spiritually. So the building will be here, or the wider church will be here, but your spirits are dying spiritually, and that is why it is not in sync with what a lot of us have to do in our churches, is to try to build and grow them. And we are fortunate, as I've always said, to have a God we can go to in times of need. I have a real life story to share with you as an example of teamwork. So at my first Episcopal church where I was a member, there was no priest when I got there. And so I got there and I said, I'm just going to sit in my pew and not do anything. I didn't tell anybody I had any talents or anything, nothing. But God works in a mysterious way. And the first thing that happened was I was sitting behind somebody and both of them turned around and said, you should be in the choir. So I go get in the choir. And then from there, this mushroom was on. And I'm one of those people that when I'm interested in something, I dive in completely and I learn all I can about it. Pretty much so it got to be where everyone would come to me and ask me questions. And I'm sitting there thinking, y'all have been here longer than me. So finally it took my senior warden to me to the side one day and he said, you've got to stop doing the thinking for them. Because by doing that, they're becoming complacent. They're depending on you to do everything, and it's not a balanced a team. They've got to do their part because once you're gone, they're going to still be here. And I think about that even to this day. The words that say you've got to stop doing the thinking for them, because as long as you're providing all the easy answers and solutions, they're going to sit back and think that's your job to do. And as we've learned from our gospel lesson, that is not the job to do. So, I'm going to bring it even closer to home. We talk about church growth. We had a very good discussion with our church growth team yesterday. Church growth requires require is a team effort. I'm new to Columbia. I can go out and pound the streets and what have you, but you all know a lot more people and have a lot more connections to inner Columbia than I do. So it takes a team effort. We can say all we want the church to grow. But if you're not out there at least inviting one person, then you're not really helping the team. But then don't ask me 5 months from now, why don't we have any new members? I'm gonna ask you, why don't we have any new members? It's a team effort. The priest cannot do everything. And that's something I had to learn as well. Someone had to tell me that literally. You're not expected to do everything. And so this is a team effort. We're all in the same boat. And this is a team effort. And I'm gonna keep saying that from Sunday to Sunday to Sunday, until I had to get to Cynthia. And it's a team effort. We just can't pray to Jesus to send us more members. We just can't hope and wish to have more members. We just can't expect that we're gonna just magically walk through the door. You have to go out and share your faith with others. It's a team effort, everyone plays a role. This is one burden that can be made very light if everyone on the team just did their part. Just invite one person. You don't have to drag them in, just extend the invitation like Jesus did in today's gospel and let God do the rest. Jesus is on our team waiting for us. I'm on the team waiting for you. Are you ready to be on the team? As I was preparing this sermon, I thought back to a hymn that we should sing all the time in Sunday school. Many of you probably know it, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. So I'm going to ask that you get your hymnals, leave us, and turn to 109.
Thank you. People, Form 4, found on page 388 in the Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others, and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy, bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them, and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy, comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, in mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Charles, Carol, Gloria, Eddie, Cynthia, Robert, Herman, Levi, James, Carmen, Cheris, Reginald, Dorothy Shiver, Gary, John, Damien, Jason, Daryl, Desmond, Peyton, Carlene, Damien, Dennis, Michelle, Latoya, Wanda, Jerlene, Carmen, Maxwell, Roosevelt, Gerald, Carl, Elsie, Margie, Larry, Dominique, Gabriel, Maddie, Oliver, Adora, Bobby, Mary. Voorhees Scholars Program, Diocesan Canterbury College Ministries, Postulant Brian McCarthy. Lord, in your mercy, we commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Almighty God, whom our needs are known before we ask, help us to ask only what accords with your will in those good things which we dare not. For in our blindness cannot ask. Grant us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let's confess our sins against God, our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess our sins against you, with God our word in me, by the love we have done, and by the love we have done. We have not loved you with our whole heart, we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. Glory to God. you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Please stand. Let us pray. Most gracious God, we give you thanks today for your servant stand before you. We give you thanks for the love and care that she shows to her loved one. We ask you to continue to be with her and walk with her on her path of faith to you. And may you continue to keep your arms around her and bless her with a wonderful birthday and many more birthdays come in the years to come. All this I ask in the name of her Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
I see her every day. I have a brain. What's your name? Okay. After service today, we will have a mid-year state of the parish meeting in the parish hall, just to give the warden and the treasurer and myself a chance to let you know where we're standing mid-year. So if you're interested in where we are standing mid-year and where we're headed, please make way to the parish hall after our service today. Also, those of you who have been coming regularly since Black History Month, I've been researching and doing work on finding our former priests and then photographs any information that I can. And in doing that, sometimes you get off on a rabbit hole. And I was linking up to other priests and things that I saw. So I said, it's very interesting because they usually have some kind of tie to St. Luke's. So today, if you're reading your bulletin, I featured two priests. The Reverend Gustav Hamilton Caution Sr. and the Reverend Canon Dr. Tolly L. Caution. For those of you that don't know, especially with Father Tolly Caution, who was very big in the Episcopal Church during a time when there was a lot of racial unrest and also reorganization of dioceses and a lot of burdens were placed upon him. He was expected to be the problem solver to get all of the Black problem solved, be the leader, be the spokesperson. And so I thought about him today as I was recording, as I was doing this sermon. And one of my goals that I've been doing is to also reach out to some of the families of these priests and invite them to church today. And we have some of the loved ones of the Caution family here with us today. Will you all stand? I didn't realize we lived right around the corner. church that I'll be preaching in the months to come. Thank you all very much for coming today, and thank you for running up to. Everything else that I normally say is in your bulletin. Just please pay attention. And we do have a baptism schedule for next month. I have to care about that. And we have three more on the horizon. So again, anyone's interested in baptism, please let me know. Our St. Luke celebration is still scheduled for October. You'll be receiving a letter later this month. And you'll hear more about that actually in our parish hall meeting after our service today. Other than that, I think I've pretty much covered everything what we've heard, everything numerous times. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you the sacrifice of thanksgiving,
we celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming.
Lord, God of our fathers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only. Now that our Savior Christ has taught